Welcome to St. James, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. That was beautiful. Thank you. Megan Sleezer is in the house. Great work on that instrument. Good to have you here in this crazy time with all the stories, right? Every social media venue has got stories for you. I get to tell and you get to hear a whole nother story. It's far deeper and greater and more awesome and beneficial than what we are stuck in our world right now. Who would like to hear a better story than what you see on the news all the time? Let's do it. And I got one. It's better, it's greater, and it's more true in Christ. So God bless your ears today. This is the baptism of our Lord we celebrate, part of Epiphany. And Epiphany basically means revelation, or Warren likes to say, aha. And throughout this season, we will see different episodes of Jesus. And I'm asking you, when you see this event that happens, what is the aha? What is God showing us about himself in his son Jesus? What light is going to dawn on you through what Christ does and says? Think about that in this sermon. And let's share the peace of Christ with one another. God's peace with you. Come on, let's share it around, everybody. We are all in this together, and God's peace to you out there watching online. Let's enjoy a little time of silence and somehow manage to clear our head of all the stuff we're thinking about and get ready for God's word to fill us up. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us pause and in our hearts give up to God our sins, not other people's, our sins. Let us confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us. renew us and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you of all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, by his authority, I forgive you of all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Father, we thank you for the story you have written us that is true, that is from the beginning and lasts forever, and the story in which you have placed us, where we are loved by you, made by you. Heavenly Father, help us to rejoice in that, believe in it, above all other stories about humanity and about ourselves, and share it with others, that there is hope and there is peace and there is a God. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the Word of God.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. This is the word of the Lord.
The voice of the Lord breaks the sea. the oak trees writhe and strips the forest bare. And in the temple of the Lord all are crying glory.
The epistle reading this morning is from the book of Romans. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Chapter. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Do you have any little people out there? I will put my mask on if you want to come up. You don't have to. I'll still do a little children's message here for those watching. All right. We have some takers. Come on up. Yes. I like the enthusiasm as well. All right. Look at this. Woo! Good morning. You guys look like you mean business. How are we doing so far? Are you having a great morning? Maybe you should do some calisthenics real quick. How's that sound? Let's do some jumping jacks. Ready? Everybody get up. Who knows how to do a jumping jack, by the way? Okay, let's see. Can you just show us for a second? Okay, let's do a couple of them. Let's go. Come on, everybody. Let's go. Oh, yeah. All right. Okay. Okay, you feeling it? Okay, that's good. Good job. You can grab a seat now. All right. All exercised out. Who has a favorite story that they love? Anybody have a favorite story that they absolutely love? You like to read it over and over and over? Yeah.
Um,
The first service, somebody told me, I think it was called Bad Kitty, The Adventures of Bad Kitty or something. Do you know that one at all? I don't know what that, anybody else have a good story? No favorite story? Well, you know what? Yes?
Three Little Pigs.
Is that your favorite story, Three Little Pigs? Okay, all right, Three Little Pigs. Sometimes, have you ever read a story or watched a movie that was so cool that you just wanted to live there and be there for a little bit? It was so awesome. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Harry Potter.
Harry Potter. Thank you. Harry Potter's like that. You're like, whoa, that is so cool. You don't want to, you want to be in the story, don't you? Right? I don't know about Three Little Pigs. Do you want to be in that story? Would you be the wolf or one of the pigs, you think? But we don't want to leave that story, right? Well, God has put us in a cool story, a real story. It's awesome. Right? What's awesome about God's story that he's put you in? You're actually in his story. Are you loved by God in that story? Yeah. Are you forgiven by God in that story? Yes. Do you know that that story is going to turn out okay? You're going to be all right at the end? Do you know that? Isn't that cool? We've been put into that story so you can always know, no matter what, God has you. And your story is going to have a great ending, right? Yeah, just like the Harry Potter series, actually, right? You're going to be okay. God loves you. Jesus died and rose for you. Isn't that cool? Awesome. Let's say a prayer. Ready? Dear Jesus, thank you for my story where you love me. Help me to love others. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming up. Good work, people. Great job. Let's sing our next song. Thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Well, like I was telling the kids, I've got probably a couple books where you read it and you don't want to leave it. Anybody else have a book where you've been in and you've read it and the last chapter comes and it ends and you're like, oh my gosh, that was awesome. I just want to stay there. Maybe you got a favorite book that you read time and time again, actually. You just enjoy it so much. And I will say that the Harry Potter series, I think J.K. Rowling just brilliantly, first of all, revived literacy in America single-handedly, writing large adult books and getting kids to read it and get them into this story. And you know, when you get a series of those, yeah, you just don't want to leave. And I'll bet there's some members of Hogwarts out there right now who secretly dress up as Harry Potter. You don't need to raise your hands, by the way. But you get those books, they just bring you in. You feel like you're a part of it. What's your favorite author? Do you have a story, a book like that? Hemingway kind of does that for me. A little more depressing, but I get into that and it's just, I'm lost in it, you know, a little bit. What's your story? I think actually everybody has a story. As if they're their own narrator. And throughout their life, literally, they're fulfilling the story that's in their head. I think everybody, I don't care who you are, has this beginning, has this purpose, has this meaning, and what's going on, and where, quite frankly, everyone has sort of an ending in their story. Where are they on this timeline? Which chapter are they? Everyone has this running story that they're sort of telling themselves in one way or the other. Some of you in your story, you might just be a little mouse watching everything unfold around you, helpless. Some of you might think you're the protagonist, the hero, and everything revolves around you. Some of you have been told stories about yourself that make you feel like a little mouse, and the things that people have said or the way you've been treated or what you have learned, you're just an obscure accident in the universe. Some of you have been spoiled, perhaps, by stories how you are number one. But we all have this constant narration, right? With a beginning and an ending. And people are always trying to get you in their story and tell you stories. Some of them are doing it pure evil, trying to invent a story for you to believe in, to get power over you. Some people are just as confused as you are as they sell stories to you for your identity, for your worldview. Today in America, we witnessed something Wednesday that I would say is the result of some people being told a story and believing in this story that this is a good thing. Do you know this? And I don't know if it's pure evil or what, but they're stuck in this story. And there's other people on the other side that have a story. And if you've noticed, I've been talking to people and I'll talk to somebody and they'll tell me a whole story of what's really going on in America and where we fit in. And it goes right down here and it's got all these enemies and evil people. And at the end, the hero is the enemy of someone else who's telling me about a story of what's really going on in America. It's the craziest time. Conflicting stories of conspiracies and what's really happening, being told by all sorts of different people that it's tiring. Who's tired of trying to figure out what's really going on? What's the story? What's the story of America? What's the story of Washington, D.C.? Well, it's important to figure this out. Just pursue truth, you bet. But I've got a better story for you that I really encourage you to find your place in. A far better story, a far more meaningful story, a far more true and real story, and a story that's so much greater than America or any kingdom or what's happening now. It's a story written by the creator of all things. God. That's what the Bible is. God actually gives us a story, doesn't he, of how things began And that story is your story. We read it earlier, Genesis chapter 1. It begins, in the beginning was God, not you. You weren't there. And God made all things out of nothing. God said, let there be light, and there was light with no help from you. The story begins with God's creation. And then, as we know, God makes man and woman. And now we look at ourselves and we're thinking that was a big mistake. And it started out well. I don't know how long, but of course, Adam and Eve had to mess it up. Because they believed another storyteller. Who's that? The devil. There's a question of whose story am I going to believe? The one who made me and has given me all these things, or the devil has another story. And guess what? When the devil tells his story, you're number one in that story. You're God. And Adam and Eve believed it, and they stole, and the world became what it is today. And mankind became, that means you too, the enemy in the story. Did you know this? In the story, you are not the hero. We're the enemy. The way we treat one another, the way we act toward one another. If you don't believe that now, I don't know what else I can say. So in the story, we see it unfold in Genesis, and we see the messed upness of man, and we see even God's people that are believers, that believe in his promises, like Abraham and David. They still screw up. They still mess up. David kills and steals and conspires against his best friend. Until finally in this story, God does something, the author does something that is really quite amazing. If you know anything about film, there's something called breaking the fourth wall. Is that right, Henry? The fourth wall. And that's when one of the characters sort of looks at the audience and smashes this perception, this division that once occurred as he speaks to the audience, knowing this is just a play, this is just a movie. I think in a way, God does that on Christmas. God, the author of this story, breaks in and becomes a character in it, a human being, a man. And not just the best, he's born to the poor, he's born to a poor couple from Galilee, a nobody in a nobody country that nobody knows of in Bethlehem. Nobody knows where Bethlehem is as a baby. God enters our story forever, intertwines himself, no longer standing on the outside, but in it. Why? Because he loves these characters he has created, you and I, even despite our unlovableness. And today we celebrate something more amazing. That God not only breaks into this story and unites himself with us on Christmas, but what happens today on the baptism of our Lord that we celebrate? There's a scene where John is telling the whole world that God is coming and he's angry. Repent and be baptized. And people stream to John, to the River Jordan to be baptized, repenting and scared. And who's standing there with them? And you'd never recognize him. God with sinners. Hanging out like a bunch of people on their way into Olive Garden. Ordinary, normal sinners. And Jesus comes to the river, and John looks at him and says, has an idea of who this one is. He's perfect. He's sinless. He's our Savior, and says, you should be baptizing me. But Jesus says, no, do it to fulfill all righteousness. And Jesus gets into the waters and is baptized. Friends, only sinners need baptism, and there's Jesus. Because God has fully involved himself in our story. He has owned our story when he walks into those waters, even not the stories of the best of us, but the stories of the worst of us when he enters that water. He becomes sin who knew no sin. He becomes a sinner. But if you think this is amazing, this day of Jesus is baptized, who shouldn't be, and unites himself with sinners and hangs out with them. But soon we see in this story, God, representing all of humanity in the flesh, your brother, on the cross as a traitor. That's what it means to be on a cross. You are a traitor to humanity, to the Roman government, and for the Jews, you are a blasphemer. You are the enemy. We're supposed to be the enemy. We're the enemy. Look at yourself. Look at this world. And yet Jesus allows himself to be called the enemy in this story. He literally is our avatar who dies for Adam and Eve, for you and for me, for your enemies, for Republicans and Democrats, for people that went into the Capitol, for people that call everybody who thinks different than them racist or communist or Nazi or whatever. Jesus took it all away in your place, in your story. He's owned your story. He's done all the heavy lifting. He entered our story and did what we failed to do, and he received what we could never stand before and died for us. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that a better story than the story you hear out there about humanity and about yourself? But more than that, this Jesus, 3 days later, rises again. So guess what? The story of mankind does not end with us destroying ourselves. But in fact, in forgiveness and in resurrection, your brother rose. Your political heroes don't rise from the dead. They have no control over that. Your philosophies can't wake up corpses. But this one can. And I say this is your story because just as God entered into our story, look what Paul says in Romans. Chapter 6. Do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death, buried with him by baptism, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life? For if we've been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Friends, the glorious story of God, he has brought you in it. In baptism, you have been brought into the story of his son Jesus, united. What happened to him will happen to you. You too will rise again. You too are a son and a daughter of God by the grace of Jesus. Is that a good story? And that story of your beginning of sin and God's love for you in Jesus and his uniting of himself to you and bringing you into his story that will not fail. His destiny is your destiny. You are the character in God's story. You're going to be okay. That transcends any stupid story that you're clutching to right now. And it's okay to kind of figure out what's going on politically and you know, what's best for America. That's fine. But the story that I'm talking to you about is so much greater than that. Far bigger. And something you can far more trust in and, quite frankly, find your identity in. Beyond your political party, your theories of what actually is really going on. I just want you to relax. You don't have to figure out these little tiny stories to scare you because you know the bigger story. and the bigger conspiracy of God to save sinners. And you know your place in a story that's far more important than America's story. Because this country, I hope it gets better, but eventually it ain't gonna be here. Kingdoms come, kingdoms go. But God's kingdom is forever. Stories come and stories go and intertwine, but they are part of a much larger overarching story and narrative told by a one who really knows what he's talking about. And you are in it as a child of God. Friends, that's why we have church services. That's why we're in God's word. That's why we need to come to church, not to give God something, but he needs to keep on telling us the real conspiracy, what's really going on, and who you are in that story, and how that story ends. And it's glorious, and it's beautiful, and it's peaceful, and it'll be a bunch of people getting along and hanging out, and no more confusion. And we can't hear that enough, because it empowers us to deal with the BS, to not get lost staring at the dirt and the trees, but we're above the forest and we see the bigger picture. We're not lost. May that story empower you and give you an identity. When you are scared of your sins and scared about you're gonna get what you deserve, Jesus took it. You're forgiven. When you're afraid of death, when you are afraid of the future, what the doctor's going to say, you will rise again. And when you are afraid of what's happening in America, God's kingdom has come, is coming, and will be triumphant as his son has risen from the dead. May that story empower you to have hope and peace in these times. And people need to hear that story. We exist because we have a story to tell. People out there in darkness and confusion and scared. And when you're like that, you start punching back and robbing and thinking everybody's out to get you. On both sides, everybody's your enemy. You can't trust anybody because they're believing and been fed lies. Purposely or not, but they're just lost in these little tiny stories, and you get to share a bigger one about the beginning, about the now, and about the end. And your neighbors need to hear this story about a God who loves them, and this city needs to hear it, and this country needs to hear that story. Get your heads out of these little concerns into this bigger world and vision and story that is God's. May the Lord bless your hearts and minds. May every day you remember whose story you are in and who you are in that story, and that destiny and that last chapter is going to be awesome. In Jesus' name, amen. This is a great time to announce we had our Alive in Christ stuff. I know you're like wondering, boy, Pastor, I've not heard you talk about Alive in Christ for a couple days. What's wrong? No, but we finished it officially like a month, 2 months ago. Wonderfully, quite frankly, right? Our original goal was 1 million. And then we thought, let's do an extension, 1.25. And then, of course, COVID hit and all that sort of stuff. And so somebody had the great idea of, well, why don't we just go for 1.5? And we ended like 1.3 when we officially ended in November. But we let it go for a month because people were still coming in with stuff. The final tally of Alive in Christ in Brace Chicago is 1.568. We killed the 1.5, we went beyond it. And I'm saying that now and telling you, first of all, praise God. Let's praise the Lord with our clap. I'm saying this because every cent is needed more than ever. It's all committed to facility stuff, like we have a heater going in right now at the school. We already had one put in the church. Simple, it's boring stuff, a lot of it. A lot of it's this cool audiovisual stuff and other things. But I want you to know, every cent is so that people will hear a better story, This city needs St. James more than ever. And it needs a school that tells kids a different story. Education's nothing if it's not encompassed in a larger story. That's what's so special about this place overall. And that's why that money is raised, and every penny is to benefit people so they can hear that there's actually hope in this world and peace, right? Amen? Yeah. All right. Let's rise and confess the story with the words of the Nicene Creed, the true story. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let's pray. We need to pray more often. We don't pray enough. I encourage you throughout this week to keep on praying for this country, for your neighbor, and pray for St. James, pray for our school that'll be opening next week, that we can do it in person. It's such a better way to do schooling, like all of our ministries. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for the story you have given us, a true one, with a good ending. Lord, help us to cling to it, and Lord, every day remember that's the story that we live in, that we can count on. And Lord, help us to share that true story of God's love for sinners in Jesus. And there is a future, and it is bright. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are scared, those who are confused, those who are living in darkness, who don't know what to believe. We pray for those that are full in, worried, and just kind of in a hole. And it goes on all sides. Heavenly Father, bring some light in there, Lord. Bring some peace. And while we pray for that, Lord, we pray for our government, our leaders. Lord, give us honest leaders that seek justice, that are above trying to get ahead politically and use crises to their career. Lord, we just beg you, Heavenly Father. We don't deserve it. We pray for it, Lord. But Lord, help us to be that in our daily lives, in our neighborhood. Help us be kind to another. Help us to speak and help us to listen. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we lift up to you those who are sick and hurting, who need your intervention. We pray for those waiting for surgery. Lord, we lift up to you those sick with COVID. We pray for an end to the pandemic. We pray for all of our nurses and doctors. Lord, we pray for the rollout of the vaccine, that it is safe. We lift up to you all those that are just worried, physically, mentally ill. Lord, be with them and heal them. We pause and we lift up to you people that are in our minds that need your prayers. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, bless St. James. Help us to thrive. Help us to be bold, have courage in moving forward so that more and more people have hope and peace in a bigger and a greater story than politics, what's happening in their life, let alone in America. So bless our school, bless our men's and women's ministries, of course, the center of things, our worship services. Bless our community, that we actually become an example of people getting along, loving one another, listening and talking, a united city on a hill. May we be that. And thank and praise you for all the resources you poured over us, Lord. May we be faithful and use everything we have so that others may know there is hope. We pray all these things, confident you hear and answer us in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. We praise and worship God with our offering. Normally we sit and pass around the plate if you're a visitor here, but now go online, stj.com, givestj.com, or you can text it, it's all right there, or in the baskets. Remember, all this goes, first of all, it's thankfulness to God for what you have, but all of it goes toward making sure people know there's hope in this world in Jesus. So pray about that and see how you can be a part of those things. Let's continue here. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is good and it is right that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For at his baptism, your voice from heaven revealed him as your beloved Son. And the Holy Spirit descended on him, confirming him to be the Christ, the answer for us. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. On the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Please be seated. For those that are newer here for communion, come on up. We try to separate family units or whatever, and you come up here, take the cup and the elements right there, and then you can either go this way or that as you safely go back to your seat. Come to the Lord's table. Take and eat the body of Christ given in death for.
Jordan Street, be the
Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the true faith unto life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank and we praise you for this holy meal that unites us to your Son. His destiny is ours. We are forgiven and we will rise again. And Lord, empower us by this meal to be Christ-like in this story, sharing the good news of Jesus, being kind to one another in words and in deeds. The city needs this more than ever. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. A couple of announcements. This Saturday we begin Christianity 101. It's on Zoom, so you can hit it wherever you're at. It's for everybody. People with doubts, people are not sure about this Christianity stuff, got questions, come and hang out with us. We'll go through the basics of the Christian faith and take those questions and those doubts and talk about those. I love to do that anyways. If you do have any challenges or needs, especially nowadays, these crazy times, you need to talk. You need someone to pray with. Please email me. Get a hold of go to the office, email, phone call, or whatever, and we'll take care of that. I would love to meet with you or maybe one of our elders or something. Let's take care of one another. Let's see here. So Christianity 101. Also, if you're interested in becoming a member, which means you agree with what's taught and you're committed to the mission and ministry that goes on here, that Christianity 101 class is for that as well. I see some a neat box in the back. We are hopefully doing more and more human care stuff. There's all kinds of little things that have been going on, and now we're trying to do some big ones where everybody, our whole St. James community, is involved in raising food, I believe, for the Lakeview Pantry. Is that correct, Emily? Does that sound good? All right, so check that out. Check out our trivia night. That's a blast. It's awesome. We're going to have it on Zoom, but you can probably bring what you, your favorite, whatever that is, for that Zoom call. And we're going to do like, we're going to do teams of some sort. And we already had some test runs, and it should be fun. So if you are not on a team, you're just an individual, you want to be in this, you'll have a blast. We'll hook you up with a team, etc. So look into that. I think you email Emily for that. And let's see here. Parking passes, if you have any, that would be great. We need not as many as we used to because there's less school stuff after 6, but we do have services coming up for Lent and other things soon. So if you live in the area, if you have some extra parking passes, that would be nice to have so we can give it to visitors so they don't get ticketed, because it looks like that's how we're going to solve our budgetary crisis, is ticketing itself, which is, you know, it's an interesting plan. So anyhow, so we could use some of those passes. There's another Bible study coming up. Also, I'm going to try to do, so we're looking at two things, and we're going to do an evening service again. I've had a number of you saying, hey, I want to go to the evening service. You're having it. It was overall pretty good, and then kind of we stopped it for December. We'd like to start it up again. If you have any thoughts on that, interest, let me know. It'll probably be a different sort of service. Michael and I are talking about that now. It'll still be God's Word, the sermon, you know, et cetera. And I would like to do some sort of college Zoom Bible study, or maybe downstairs in person. If you're a college kid, meaning you're not in high school, you're not of drinking age, hanging out with our young professional group, which is a great group, but you're in one of our many colleges all around us, and you'd like to have some hangout time or whatever, email me, okay? Go on here, email me, let me know you're interested. We'll do it on Zoom, or maybe we'll do it downstairs, trying to figure that out, but I hope to set that up soon. Once again, thank you to Mike Welch and the Capital Campaign Committee that has set us on just a beautiful course, and thank you for all your giving that we get to conclude 2020. In this crazy world, God is blessing James immensely, but only so that we may be a blessing to others. I know it's weird to say, but I'm really excited about this year and what God is going to do. These are good times to be church, to be Christians, because we have good news for people who are tired of bad news. Amen? Let's do it. Let's sing our last song. serve the Lord.
Oh, sing hallelujah, Christ, he lives, and what reward.